Good evening. I'm delighted to welcome you to the Great Hall tonight for the inaugural Girls Division Platt Fisher Lecture. And I extend my thanks to you all for joining me to hear from Sheila at this very special event. Although being able to meet virtually has been a lifeline for many over the last 2 years, it's both a pleasure and a privilege to be able to gather together in person in school on occasions such as this. That said, I'm also delighted to be able to extend this welcome to the many old girls and others who are watching tonight's lecture via the live stream. This hybrid approach to events means that so many more members of our school community are able to be part of events such as tonight's lecture, and is one outcome of the pandemic that we will be pleased to retain. I'm hugely proud that the Platt Fisher Lecture, the Girls Division first ever annual lecture series, has been established during my first year as head. It's a real honour to be able to inaugurate such a prestigious tradition, particularly as we are doing so in recognition of the service of old girl Dr Sheila Fisher, née Platt, who retired from the Foundation's governing body in December last year after 37 and a half years of service. Sheila has lived a life of true service to the school, to her local community, and to her profession. Her approach to life encapsulates that famous exhortation from the Girls Division prayer, "Much is required of those to whom much is given." This is what we urge our pupils to strive for, and we are inordinately thankful to Sheila for the time, the commitment, and the energy that she has dedicated to the Foundation for so long. Sheila is a shining example to the current generation of pupils here at school of how to live your life to make a difference for good. And I'm delighted that she has accepted our invitation to deliver this inaugural lecture in order that she might share some of the lessons that she has learned along the way. Thank you, Sheila, from everyone in the Girls Division and across the Foundation for the many ways that your service has benefited us all over so many decades. We are forever in your debt. I shall now hand over to Summer Kay, this year's head girl, who will introduce Sheila's lecture.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Summer Kay, and I've been honoured to be the Girls Division head girl for this academic year. As you can expect, I've not stood at this lectern as often as head girls before me have, but I'm thrilled to welcome you tonight to the Great Hall, or virtually, to the first lecture of the Platt Fisher series. I'm sure you'll agree that it's very exciting for us to be able to celebrate the start of a new tradition here at Bolton School Girls Division, and I feel very lucky to be able to introduce the first lecture of many to come. The Platt Fisher series has been established in honour of Dr. Sheila Fisher, our keynote speaker for the evening, who I've had the pleasure of meeting multiple times and warmly welcome back to the school. Dr. Fisher is an old girl who attended the Girls Division between 1963 and 1970 before going on to study medicine and surgery and a master's in the healing of surgical laser wounds at the University of Birmingham. After this, Sheila obtained a PhD in patient experiences of head and neck cancer at the University of Leeds and more recently attended York St. John University, where she completed a postgraduate degree in theology and ministry. Sheila's career as a successful surgeon will be especially relevant to many pupils here intending to study medicine at university, and so I can imagine the special interest of those members of the audience to hear what Dr. Fisher has to say. Having been a member of Bolton School's governing body for over 37 years, Sheila retired from her position in December. Sheila's post included a time as vice chair for the Girls Division Governors, and so you can imagine the changes she's seen and had a voice in implementing in her time. As you know, tonight's lecture is titled Learning from Living, where Sheila will be discussing her experience of juggling leading a successful career as a surgeon, her voluntary work, and being a mother, whilst living and working in a career dominated by men. As you're about to hear, Dr. Fisher will also be expressing her thoughts on what matters the most in our lives, what she's learnt over the years, and the importance of making a difference in the world for good. Once again, I'd like to say how exciting the Platt Fisher Lecture Series is, and that I'm sure it will make a fantastic addition to all of the other enrichment events and activities that school puts on. I look forward to seeing its progression and the lectures to follow in the future. I'd now like to welcome Sheila. Thank you.
Well, good evening. Now, how do I follow that? I'll do my best. Okay. So it is a joy and a wonder to be back in this hall. The first time I did it, I walked sort of that way back in very early 1963. And at that time, I thought it was the most beautiful space I'd ever seen. I've been back so many times over the years. Every time, it still feels like coming home. So let's go back to that time. 1960s was a remarkable decade. It was a real time of hope after a time of war, a time of austerity, and for us as women, and I am talking particularly to women, but I'm friends with men, so I hope it's of interest to men as well. It was something of a dawn of freedom, because it was a decade when so many pieces of domestic drudgery were swept aside by the new labour-saving machines. We weren't measuring the cost on the planet at that time. We were measuring our freedom, and that was a good thing. So this is an evening to celebrate, probably above all, our founder's vision for bringing together a boys' school and a girls' school so generously, because that means that as pupils of this school, we can dare to hope and dream in a way that was not possible for previous generations. And as the children of the 60s, we knew it all. We really did. Actually, I'm going to tell you how wrong that was. So what was it like to be an aspiring woman in those times, and especially an aspiring woman in the world of men? Well, I believe that most of life's experiences are shared. The triumphs and the bad times, the joys and the sad times, most of all, choosing our paths and choosing our dreams. And some of the things I'll say, I am hoping that I might be a little bit controversial, might be a bit more challenging, hope it'll be at least be interesting. So here goes. I look back on my life and I realized that pretty well every decade had brought something new. And I'm not alone in that. The Dean of Edinburgh Business School, his previous headhunter and Times columnist, has said, and I think it's good advice, that we should look back on our lives about once every 10 years. We should take stock of where we are, and we should think what we want to do with the next 10 years. So maybe this 10-year cycle isn't me, maybe it's us. So let's go back to the beginning. In our early life, we are utterly dependent on others. And our future is dependent on the fortune that we're given in the people that we meet. And I do want to talk about an absolutely wonderful man who really gave me my foundation for living. He was called John Alston. He was the headmaster of our little village school, our little Victorian village school. And I learned very early, one of the big headlines, teachers are inspirational. Teachers change your life. So there we are. If you take nothing else away tonight, take that one. But my education started really badly. My baby sister came into the world on my first day at school, and nobody thought to take me. And on the fourth day, Mr. Alston came into our infants class and said, can you walk really quietly out of school? Don't touch anything, don't take anything, walk slowly out of school. Unlike this hall, as I walked out of school, I looked at the hall roof. You know, the bright blue autumn sky was so, so beautiful. So but by the end of the fourth year of my education, school was a pile of rubble in the road. Not the best of starts. I wasn't the best of starts. I was painfully shy, I was little, I got goofy teeth and I got a speech impediment. So I was really such promising material. And yet, John Alston saw something. He saw I wanted to learn. And when we got back to our new school, he would just very quietly say, I think you might like to have a go at that. And when I was 10, he asked Mum and Dad to go into school, and he gave them the entrance form for here. And he said, I've taught her what I can. She needs to go there. And his care, his wonderful care, was rewarded because I did get a Lancashire County scholarship, and I did indeed walk into this hall. And I just want to celebrate his gift, because without him and without his inspirational care as a teacher, I would very definitely not be here today. His daughter Elaine helped me overcome the speech impediment, and I'm hoping that Elaine is online this evening. And I did stay friends with him throughout his very long life. So let's get on to arrival here, second decade. And I think this is a decade of so much promise. This is about learning to live in all life's fullness. And teenage years are a bit of a puzzle, aren't they? You know, we start it as a child and we come out of it like an adult. And it's a real transition. And we need rules for living. And another time, sitting about there in this hall, the redoubtable Margaret Higginson gathered us, the new third form, and she told us very firmly, we had been gifted talent. And she shared, as Lynn did, the school prayer. You remember, much will be required of those to whom much is given, and we have to be thankful that our lot is cast in so goodly a heritage. So what were the important things to do? Well, I've highlighted two. Make friends, friends who will be friends throughout life, and to grasp that goodly heritage across all its facets. So under the eye of Mrs. Tate, who some of us will remember so well, who would have doubled as a second mum to most people, I just looked across, and the first person I saw was Aileen, who's there this evening. Soon after, we had a group of friends, so Aileen's sister Janet also with us, Vanessa and Elizabeth, together with, I know, quite a lot of our school friends are online this evening. You really must, you make these wonderful friends at school, always cherish them. Never take them for granted, always cherish them. They are so, so much part of your life. And we came together last year for our 50th anniversary. We might have been walking those corridors yesterday. So coming back to education, I expected a good academic education. What I got was so much more. I gained a love of literature, very often shared with our group of friends. I became aware how beautiful classical music was and the joy of singing, joys that are as active and as alive today as they were then. But most of all, it was that intangible thing. It was the ethos of this wonderful school, the qualities that light its core, that have been the greatest gift. And that, together with the confidence to believe in myself, that I could accomplish my dreams, and that I could also do good, not only for me, but for others, and that on the whole, doing that might even be fun. But then we come towards the end of our school days, no matter how wonderful they've been, and we start to think about our futures, and that is where so many of you are this evening. And I think we need to ask one really fundamental question. Who am I? Do we take enough time to ask that? And I would say, if we're looking to be happy and fulfilled in our lives, we do need to understand who and what we are and what drives us. Does career matter most? Might it be family life that lies at our core? Do we want a mix? Is a mix actually possible? Lots and lots of questions. I actually found a book helped me understand me. So the author and aero-engineer, Neville Shute, wrote that his talent was to work and develop things. But once they were developed, he needed to move on because he wasn't good at keeping them going. And even at 16, I sort of thought, yeah, I can see that. And I know now that I need to be challenged. I need to always have a goal to strive towards for myself and with those I work with, if I am to be happy and fulfilled. So I'm always pleased I read that book. If we go back to A-level choices, they were quite constrained in our time. Universities said, if you are going to do that, these are the subjects you will study. Now today, we've had the joy as a small group of people of interviewing some of the boys for the Popplewell scholarships. Tomorrow, we're meeting some of you again for the Warburton scholarships. And this is always a joy. And what I see now, and what I think is important for all of you making your choices, is that there's more flexibility. I think there's more flexibility in what you can choose, and there is more flexibility in the way that you can expect to live your lives. So if we go back to the world I became an adult in, it was expected it would be a very traditional model. And in fact, in their book, 100-Year Life, Professors Sarah Harper and Linda Grattan actually challenge that view. So how we saw it, you know, full-time education, full-time career, maybe a break for childcare, full-time retirement when you're sort of like past it, really. In these times, old age tends to be seen more as 80s and 90s as the population demographics change. And it is likely our life of work and other aspects of life will become more flexible, that we will evolve, we may take time out to retrain, we probably will work longer, but we may not necessarily work full time. And, you know, I think that's really exciting. So, the way of living now allows us to really follow our choices. And it's time for another decade, and something that wasn't so nice, but something that you will all face. The time life goes pear-shaped. Okay. So, during sixth form, two of my uncles died from cancer. My own father became very unwell, and my life became very different. From being a carefree schoolgirl, I travelled after school to the office of the family firm, helped with the account books, then home for a snack before hospital visiting. With Mum a hazard on the roads because she drove home in tears every night, passing my driving test became the number one priority. Homework fitted in where it could. So it's hardly surprising that my A-level grades fell short of those needed for medicine. Miss Higginson, in those pre-clearing days, in close touch with universities, said, "What about dentistry?" Well, I knew I liked doing practical things, and I went to see my dentist, and everything was encouraging, but I was asked to make a promise to give up on my medical ambition, and transfer would not be an option. Dentistry was not a back door to medical school. Well, I was the first one from my family to look to go to university. The chance was there, and my father's health remained uncertain. And it felt wise, and I still feel it was, to take the chance that was offered. After the first term, I knew I had made the worst mistake I could. Dentistry is a terrific career for those who want to practice dentistry. Now, I don't know where it came from, but it was either derived from my experience of my uncle's illness, or just simply the deep instinct within each of us that tells us what we are meant to be. I felt I somehow had to have a place in cancer treatment, and somehow I got to find that place. So I think for all of us, as we're thinking through major decisions, do recognize your dreams. Recognize them, know them, and never be afraid to follow them, no matter how hard that is. And what happens when you're trapped? Well, there are always strategies. Can you get out? Well, my promise had taken away that option. You can give up, and quite a few people get close to giving up. I don't recommend that at all. You just come out with nothing if you give up. Or you can endure and see where the path takes you. And that can become a blessing. And for me, the way forward became clear in the senior years when we started to observe and assist with surgery around the mouth and jaws. We had an elective period, and I arrived at the hospital to find the morning's planned activity was just scrapped. It was just gone because we were giving urgent care to somebody who'd been in a severe road accident. So for the next 3 hours, I watched the skill with which the broken bones were carefully pieced together, and I cut the ends of sutures as the face and neck tears were layer by layer carefully repaired. And at the end of this, I said, okay, how do I train to be able to do this? And in response, I was told about the new specialty of maxillofacial surgery, literally jaw and face surgery. It required a full surgical training, but it also required the detailed knowledge of the complex anatomy of the face and jaws that can only be gained from a dental degree. So suddenly, I had a destination again, but how to get there? Well, after graduation, I based my career in the hospital service, and in my first interview, I competed against two close women friends. There were three jobs, but they weren't going to appoint three women, were they? Well, they did. All three of us were appointed, the first cohort of house surgeons that was totally female. At no time was I ever interviewed in competition with another woman again. There simply weren't any. So, time to get into a world of men. How do we not only survive, but thrive? And despite much progress, I think we have to acknowledge it is still true that ingrained perceptions and even misogyny are far from being dead. We've made progress, but we are not yet there. And yet, if we show ourselves to be really open and committed and skilled, we gain respect. I do feel that at least in the beginning, we often have to work harder. But actually, once there, especially if we've got rarity value, we get noticed. And once you're known to be good, it can become a really positive cycle of opportunity and success. And you know, working with men, it can be a real pleasure. And I'm so pleased I'm saying that tonight because I've done it for the past 30 years. So finding your feet as a woman in a man's world, well, starts with first steps. At my next interview, there were four male applicants. I felt, they looked around, why's that woman here? What's she doing? What's she here for? At the interview, I was very aware of the lay chair. He had to question the applicants and said, what am I going to ask her? Anyway, I got ready. And to what do you do in your spare time? I replied that given my spare time was one day off a fortnight, I did something that would take my mind totally off work. I flew light planes from Manchester Airport. It turned out he was a veteran from the RAF. My own first solo flight had been at the airport where he served. So suddenly the complexities of flight dynamics, the sheer freedom of flight, and the thrill of aerobatics over Southport Beach were clearly mutual territory. We outran the interview schedule by a mile. And yes, I got the job. And the important thing there is in doing that, I sent my first marker out into what was really quite a small field, that I was someone to be reckoned with. I was not a token presence. But there was still the need to recapture the dream. And entry into medical school was difficult. And as a woman, I felt I might find it more so. But you build your future, and my rescue this time was my first boss. He was now Dean of Manchester Medical School, and he gave me his blessing. But life throws in complications. Just remember that. Whatever you do, whenever you've got it sorted, something happens. And during these months, I'd met John. So what do you do? Medical education here, man you want to spend your time with there. Was there a way past this one? So I asked about a transfer. The academic dean was very sympathetic. And then he threw in the hardball. It can only be approved if you get married, and you need to do it by Easter to move at the end of this academic year. Okay, folks, have you ever considered planning, organising, and actually having your wedding in 5 weeks? Does that appeal? Right, well, I'm going to be controversial. Do you know, it was great. I really recommend it. Within 48 hours, our minister at church had found a gap between two other weddings and put us in. We went to our preferred place for the reception, and the owner turned out to be an old school friend of my mum's, so the evening thing got sort of moved back a bit, and we had our reception where we wanted. And it was a delightful, really relaxed and happy day. Now, probably parents will throw things at me if some of you take that away as an idea, but there's always a way to do things. But then, who am I now? And again, this is a decision you'll have to think through. Was I Mrs. Fisher, the wife, or Miss Platt, the surgeon in training? Do we wish to be identified through our union with someone we love? Or does our own identity from our own family matter? Does it even need to be the same in all settings? And the answer is not the same for each of us, but at least stop and think about it. Now, for me, there were three issues. Two were practical. So very soon after our marriage, I was in Hamburg to give a talk at a conference. For work reasons, I had to fly really late in the evening. So I found myself at 1 o'clock in the morning, tired and disheveled, trying to convince a very suspicious hotel receptionist that Miss Platt and Mrs. Fisher were the same person, and that he could please let me have the key to my bedroom. Okay, not easy. The second one is a warning for all prospective parents. Be careful when you name your child. Surgery is a profession where nicknames stick, and if people can find one, they will give you one. So, Sheila Platt, did I want to spend my next 30 years as Splat? Yeah. Would you? Would that be a choice you would make? But the final one is rather more reflective. It did feel right to get the message out there to aspiring young women that there were surgeons who were misses. Marriage and children might not be easy, but they're not a barrier to a surgical career. So I brought the two main pillars of life, career and marriage, together and became Mrs. Fisher. And during the next decade, even the dream came true. Surgical training was all I could possibly imagine. There were real advances, very much due to technical innovation. So suddenly, rather than wiring broken jaws together, we could put little bone plates on, and we could do it so precisely. The invention of the surgical microscope allowed us to remove cancers and pick up living tissue, bone, muscle, skin, with the blood vessels, and carefully put them into place as a living replacement for what had gone. This was truly revolutionary, and it was a joy to be part of it. Even beyond work, it was a good time. John and I could enjoy our shared love of mountains and mountain walking, at home in the European Alps, and later in Slovenia, where we went up the highest peak Triglav in a day of just celebration of the world and its beauty. I even had the chance to go to Japan to present my research. So of course I took the chance to ascend Mount Fuji. I mean, it's there, why not go up it? As this decade drew to a close, there was one thing in life that was missing. I'd always hoped to have a child. And yet, as I put it to my friends, my hours of duty were such that nobody would trust me with a goldfish, never mind a child. But as ever, life delivers, and my senior training post at Liverpool gave a window of opportunity that was a short period away from the demands of the cancer service. And Peter, our eldest son, very kindly appeared during that time, very good of him. And he was actually welcomed by the whole centre, by so many colleagues and friends. And yet, despite that welcome, fitting care of a baby and a surgical career isn't easy. Surgical skills decay very quickly, and I, by then, was our family's wage earner because John had taken early retirement. But within 12 weeks, we had an excellent nanny, and I was back enjoying cancer surgery. Now, is that a hard thing to say in a world where we really promote mother-child bonding? And it may be controversial of me, but I certainly feel that for me and for many other women, you're actually better following your own vocation, even if it does mean sitting with a breast pump in a corner of behind an operating theatre where you can't be seen, than you would be at home, feeling that you have to look after this tiny child when actually your heart and soul wants you back at work. So it was coming to time to practice as a consultant. And as ever, there's an extra. So on the evening, and of course remember Liverpool camp party, as we gathered for my leaving party in the splendour of the Art Deco ballroom at the Hotel Adelphi, I was asked a question. Hi Sheila, what are you drinking? What was my reply? Orange juice, please. Yes, the cheer nearly raised the roof. Our second son Robert was on the way. So for my consultant post, I'd chosen Nottingham. Even more importantly, they chose me as well. They had ambition to build a microvascular cancer service, but they had far less idea of what it involved. And as many of you know, these operations are complex, usually done by two teams of surgeons, and even then they take quite a few hours. With just me training everybody else, it wasn't really helpful that they'd give me half-day afternoon operating lists. So what did we do? We simply worked into, sometimes we worked through the night, and we learned together fast. We worked so well together, and we gained a reputation for good results. So in time, the operating time, the required equipment, and expansion in terms of our staff did follow. And our success was celebrated. We actually featured prominently in a documentary filmed in 1997. It was called Intensive Care. But as the footage was being pulled together, I faced a series of phone calls. Because what did I want to do? I wanted the word maxillofacial up front and center. And sometimes you have to be firm and go, I'm going to have this, whatever. So over a morning of negotiation, we had a number of conversations to the point where I clearly got somebody senior in the end because I recognized their name from the television. And he just said, you're consultant surgeon. That's what you're going to be. I'm the editor. It's my decision. So, right. Time sometimes you land the killer blow. So I said, that was fine. That was his decision. But what I could guarantee was that at some point in the next 15 minutes, my patient would be on the phone to him and she would be withdrawing her consent for the footage to be broadcast. Surprise, surprise, I got my way, and the word maxillofacial was used with enthusiasm. But this did bring back elements of gaining recognition as a female surgeon. You know, it was really good that the Radio Times gave their headline to our programme. It was a programme of the week. I was miffed when the piece talked of the surgeon showing his skill in facial reconstruction. To be fair to them, they did give my very pithy letter their star letter slot in the next issue, together with a few very gracious words of apology. But some battles do go on and on and on. I think one important facet of being a female surgeon or any other really demanding job with children is sort of what do you do with the competing aspects of life? And my children are my greatest blessing. And I really was determined that whatever it took, I would have time with them. So I changed things. You don't do that in hospital practice, but I did. So I assigned the morning ward round to my senior trainee in the team. So I took the boys to school. I then picked up on queries and complications. And in the evening, unless I was operating, I made certain I went home on time. The boys and I had tea together. We talked through their day, after homework, games, or both. I saw them into bed with a story or a book. I then went back to the hospital to do my own ward round and to catch up on any tasks that hadn't been completed. Now, when I say this, people can sometimes be, you know, poor you having to do that. But actually, it was a real blessing because I could do my job and I could live my life with my family. And the people I felt sorry for, and this is very much a message for some of the men here, my male colleagues felt tethered to a way of working, going back to that traditional model of life. Turn up in the morning, you stay till everything's done, and then you go home. And so many of my male colleagues missed out on the entirety of their children's childhood years. So, you know, be imaginative, whether you're a man or a woman, make your life work for you. Do your job fully, but make your life work for you. There's another privilege to being a consultant, and it's a two-edged sword. You become in parallel a surgical trainer and an educator, but your task is to guide a young surgeon to become as good as you before they leave. And then you know that's their springboard. They're now going to go higher. So isn't it wonderful? It's like built-in obsolescence, really. But 10 years on, we had a centre to be proud. But it was time for my restless streak to come up. And I'd known for a couple of years that we were pretty well there. So I'd started to build research collaborations. And I just needed something new again. I could have coasted through, but I wanted something new. And one of the things I'd done was built up research collaborations with a group working in advanced biomaterials for jaw reconstruction and to look at spectroscopy and its role in cancer diagnosis. And a senior lectureship, so 50% NHS, 50% university, came up in Leeds. So time for another leap of faith. And I think the headline here is, if you're going to live life to the full, just go with the chances offered. Be bold. If you just stay with the safe and secure, you spend your time looking back over your shoulder and going, if only. And this change led to a very different but equally rewarding second career. And it was refreshing and reinvigorating and something of a reinvention of me. We did have a problem with head and neck cancer funding. It was like the bottom, it was like underneath the ground somewhere if you just didn't have head and neck cancer funding. But there were a whole group of us determined to change that. So we worked with the National Cancer Research Network and we devised studies and we made them work. Our major one needed 5,000 patients. Our American collaborator promised to eat her hat if we got anywhere near that number. Now, I'm still waiting to see the video of it because our recruitment closed at 5,500. And I think she let us down. I don't think she ever did eat that hat. But the thing was, we proved we could do it. We got funding, and what we were learning started to take us through to better outcomes. So it was time then to eventually come towards the word I hate. Horrible word, retirement. Yeah? Because it's got connotations, hasn't it? You know, you've done it. People, when they see it, what did you used to be? Not what are you now? And actually, usually if you've got a man with you, what did he used to do? And I think this is something that in this more flexible way of living, we really have to push back for. You know, what it does, it's not stepping back into a shadow land. There's so much to offer, so much still to do, so much more life to be lived to the full. You revise your currency. It's not your salary anymore, it's your time, and it must be reflected, respected and used well. And then the unexpected happens again, and for me that was COVID. So yeah, it was all well controlled. I was getting established in ministry, which is something I wanted to do. I'd become a trustee of the hospice. It was all good. And then the General Medical Council sent a nice little letter. You can be useful. Would you like your registration back? So I started as a volunteer in staff support. I'd spent years behind PPE. I knew how to listen to people who were finding it different. But soon the vaccination program was launched, and doctors and experienced senior nurses were needed to manage the medical queries, to try to keep up with guidelines that changed every week, sometimes twice a week. And it could be quite arduous. And for a completely unplanned year, this became the core of my activities. But I can say that despite having a really active, really happy life that's been joy and fun, I've never actually felt more proud than putting back on that rainbow badge of the NHS. And we all worked and we learned together and we supported and we cared for each other. And beyond any expectation, this has been a terrific time. Not many people say that about COVID, do they? But actually, for me, it was a terrific time. Patients were always at the core, and the most memorable were the 90-year-olds, because in those very early days, we couldn't waste a single dose of vaccine. And behind the scenes, the staff were on the phone saying, can you get here in half an hour? If you can, you can have it. And suddenly, out of the dark, cold February night, these people arrived who hadn't been out for months. Some of them said, you said come, so we left our tea on the table. We'll eat it when we get home. And they were in their house slippers. And these people were just so wonderful and so totally committed to coming, getting their vaccine. There were stories. There were stories of heartbreak. You know, this is too late for my wife. This is too late for people in my family. And there were stories of hope and expectation. We will get through this. Thank you for doing this. We'll get through this. And there was the thing that was not allowed. There was the COVID hug. Because some of them just went, thank you. And then they went, oh, I shouldn't have done that. So I think a lot of them needed the hug. They needed the hug as much as they needed the vaccine. So what about this other element of my life? This wonderful place. Well, we finally came out of COVID restrictions and our governing body could finally recruit some new members. So it was time for me for a slightly delayed farewell after so, so many happy years. And being a governor's always remained fresh. There's always something new. There's always a further aspiration for this wonderful place and all its people. And I've had the pleasure of serving with so many colleagues and with a succession of chairs and school leaders, each of whom has brought their own individual and unique talent to their role. And it's a great pleasure now to see the new structure come into being, to bring both a coherence to the foundation while supporting the flourishing of all three schools. And I think the bringing junior education fully into step with boys and girls education is a real leap forward, and I really welcome that. But of course, we have challenges in our world, and we've seen the problems with mass migration. We heard in the Tillotson lecture the problem about how we see other human beings, that all humans have their place, and that we must value all human life. That can be difficult practically because there are things on a very individual level we can do and we can't. And we are told, as those to whom much has been given, that we should give what we can. So in common with so many people, I do hope that a Ukrainian family will come and live in my home before too long. What else am I doing? Well, ministry's up and running, and I think again at turbulent times, it's important. The church is there to be a solace, to be a comfort, to be there in times of joy and sadness. So I think that really, really matters. And my second main commitment is being a trustee at the Wigan and Lee Hospice. And again, I think the whole idea of time around end of life is something that we've not really engaged with as society. The kind of work, the best of palliative care is wonderful, but it tends to be patchy. So the thing I'm really proud of for this next decade, because I'm about to go to another one, is that there is a new initiative led by Wigan and Lee Hospice with Bolton Hospice and a number of other hospices to actually get that talent out into the wider world. So into care homes, into the community, working with all our colleagues in primary care, so that people who maybe don't see the end of life very often will have the confidence and the backup to really help people. To me, as a hospital doctor, every life that ends on a trolley in A&E is a tragedy. And if I'm going to commit my next few years to making something work, it's the ministry and it is that work at the hospice. So right, it might be another decade, but you know, I'm not finished yet. And no matter how old we are, we still have an awful lot to offer. So what of all of you? What about our young generation? Well, a few headlines as we close. Know yourself. Know what matters most to you. Value your friends. Go for your dreams and never be afraid to pursue the opportunities life offers. Treat others and treat our world gently and with respect, and always try to do good for others as well as for yourself. Despite the challenges of today, and we don't live in an easy world, we know that, you are the ones who hold our hopes for a better world, and you all have the skill and the confidence to make it so. So I wish you all every blessing as you go forward, learning from your own lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. We are going to take some questions from the audience now, so do have a think about what you might like to ask Sheila. We'll spend maybe 10 or 15 minutes on questions, but before we pass over to your questions, can I just say thank you to Sheila for her fascinating, astonishing and inspiring examples. As we walked into the hall earlier tonight, Sheila said to me, when it was far too late for me to do anything about it, I'm going to be controversial tonight, and I was worried, but I didn't need to be. I'm very grateful to you for your range of anecdotes there, and I'm sure that parents are also equally grateful to know that it is actually possible to plan a wedding in 5 weeks, and you might take that into the future with you when your children are at that point. I'm sure they're quite relieved to hear that. Anyway, we'll pass over with the help of the Development Office and Emma there to any questions that you might like to ask. So who would like to start?
Hi. First of all, thank you. That was very interesting, very inspiring, so that was great. You talk about following your dream and planning for that, you know, your education and all of those things. Is it the case, though, that many people, the way their lives evolve, is through luck and happenstance, and I just happened to be in the right place at the right time, those type of things. Has that happened to you?
Yes. Yes, I mean, you don't know what's going to happen, and I suppose the biggest example of that was the fact that my life went in a direction that really took an awful lot of my hope away. And yet, in the end, it was a blessing, because if I'd never done that dental degree, I couldn't have been a maxillofacial surgeon. And I couldn't possibly have known that. And it turned out to be the career that was perfect for me. Things like the intricacy of the anatomy, I like fine motor work, the sort of interest of the area, because it's so visible, it's so functional. Treat a cancer in that area, is the person going to be able to speak again? Are they going to be able to eat? What's it doing to their appearance? It all actually fitted with what could be my dream, but without what felt at the time to be a massive wrong turning, it could never have come to fruition. So you're absolutely right. And I think with the more flexible lives we're living now, I think it is notice those moments, capture those moments, and go for them. It's a bit the same with the move to the university job. I wasn't to know that was going to come up. When it did, it was like, yes, that's it, go for it.
From what Summer said and from what you sort of said throughout the speech, it seems like you sort of went back into education and back into academia with the PhD and the postgraduate study. Do you think that that was like particularly beneficial to you? Do you find that sort of enriching your education further has been like better for your life? Would you recommend that?
Yeah, I mean, I think having the chance to teach anything is wonderful. There is actually a bit of background as to why it's sensible that way around. Because with this kind of surgery, you're at your best, most of us are, when you're relatively young. So do the really practical part first. But certainly when I got to be 50, I was just a little bit aware that my hands were just that little bit less flexible, that my eyesight wasn't quite as precise anymore. And you sort of know you're there, you're respected, you've got your place, but you sort of look 5 years on when everything's a little less easy and there's this background muttering, she used to be good once. Whereas the other side of it is, even though very often research is seen as being a young person's thing with the imagination, the creativity, for my kind of research, having that clinical background and having that long experience of both cancer and trauma, the way that cancers develop, the way we could treat them, the way that we could mend fractures, and long experience of doing it, I knew what we needed to get better. So actually doing it that way around turned out to be ideal. And maybe as we've had experience of things, maybe it does help us teach. Certainly the chance to teach, the chance to be with and talk with young people is as much a joy now as it ever has been.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mrs. Fisher. From a fellow female surgeon, I just want to say thank you very much for talking to the girls about the potential opportunities for them. My question is two-pronged. Number one, would you still recommend medicine as a career in this day and age? And number two, what would the best single piece of advice be to those that you are recommending that career to?
Sorry, can you just say the second bit again?
What would be the single piece of advice that you would offer to anybody wanting to follow a career in medicine, particularly girls?
Go for it.
Yeah.
I do. I mean, it has been a most amazing career. Lovely to meet someone else who does it. And it's been a joy, as my career evolved, to see more women come into it. And I'm hoping we are making it easy, but I would say, still not easy, is it?
Not at all.
No.
Still
I think I'm an orthopaedic surgeon, so even more so, any surgical career, as you say. But I think we're seeing a lot more women coming through, and I think it's really being promoted. I think you have to be a special kind of person to manage it all the way through. But yeah, I think we should be definitely encouraging girls who have an interest.
I would agree, you know, and I think it's something to get a feel for. Yeah. I knew I'd got to do it. I knew I would not be happy if I did anything else. And I'd be looking over my shoulder going, could you have got there? Could you have done it? And that would have nagged through to my dying day, you know. You could have done it if only you'd put your heart and soul into it. And I'm glad I did. And I would actively encourage any of you. I think on the wider thing of medicine, it's such a varied career. Actually, oddly enough, you can be a good doctor if you don't like people. There are parts of medicine where you don't even have to go near people. You can be a good different doctor if you love people, and I would say in surgery that it's very much about the relationship with the people. If they are going to trust you to do something actually practical and physical to them, you have to have their trust. And it's just as much about the relationship of trust as it is about the technical part of it.
Hello. It seems that so much of what you've talked about has focused on the idea of knowing yourself and believing in yourself. So how do you think is the best way to respond when people try to disparage you and try to stop you from doing those things?
Yeah, it's all good. I think there is the belief in yourself. You have to, I mean, it goes back to almost that first interview. I was very aware that everybody except me went, what's she here for? And don't rise to it. Just prove that you're good. Always be courteous. Always be firm. So don't give ground. But none of us get to where we want to be by being too prickly. Okay, be firm like I was with that TV producer. But on the whole, try to work with people. Look to persuade them. If you show that you're good, people will give you credit for being good. If people are trying to pull you away from your dreams, push back. This is me. This is what I want to do. Now, sometimes it turns out that it's not the right thing. And if that becomes apparent, going back to what the gentleman said, maybe that life delivers something different. So I'm not saying be totally inflexible. But yeah, don't be disparaged. And I think another big headline, don't disparage others. I think sadly as humanity, it's so easy to say that cutting word, so easy to say that unkind thing. Actually, as men and women together in this world, the world's bad enough, you know, let's lift each other up and do what we can to support and help each other. And if we all keep trying to do that, maybe people won't be quite so disparaging.
Thank you.
Thank you, and that probably is a lovely point to end on. Just to pick up on a couple of themes from those questions, you are absolutely right, it does take a very special kind of person, but also a huge amount of effort and a huge amount of will to be that lucky, as you asked in the first. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us. I'm going to pass to Manahill now, who will give her vote of thanks.
Good evening. It is my privilege as Deputy Head Girl to have been asked to deliver the vote of thanks on this very special occasion. As you are all aware, this evening has marked the inaugural Platt Fisher Lecture, the very first of what will be a series of many inspiring future lectures which will undoubtedly help to enrich and educate us all. I strongly believe that old girls and current students at this foundation particularly appreciate the traditional nature at the core of our community. We are a school built on many traditions that always seem to excite those who experience them. It is not very often that one has the privilege of seeing a new tradition unfold, and I am very grateful to have witnessed Dr. Fisher's lecture mark the beginning of this very exciting new addition to the numerous enrichment events available at our foundation. Therefore, on behalf of the students, staff, parents, governors, special guests, and indeed myself, I would like to express my wholehearted thanks to Dr. Fisher for imparting on us her advice and experiences as an all-girl governor, doctor, and mother. It was truly awe-inspiring to hear from you about how you managed to juggle a successful career along with volunteering and striving to enact positive change. I'm particularly in awe of your commitments to medicine despite various challenges, as well as the positive changes that you helped introduce to the school, which you so evidently love. I believe this is clear through your time tonight how we can indeed learn from living life to the fullest and not simply survive, but thrive. We are privileged as a foundation to have had such an accomplished woman oversee our school, and her positive influences on the way our school has developed are undeniable. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being with us this evening for the inaugural Platt Fisher Lecture. I'm sure I can speak for both the audience and myself when I say we have very much enjoyed this informative and inspiring lecture. Please join me in expressing our gratitude for Dr. Fisher, or should I say Splat, with a round of applause.
So do join us for refreshments in the Levy Hume if you would like to. Sheila will be here in the hall and also in the Levy Hume later to answer any questions if you want to chat with her informally. Well, thank you very much for joining us, and I wish you a safe journey home.